Tom, how are you?
I'm doing great. How are you?
I'm not too bad at all. I'm just getting ready to key up our next movie talk.
You know it. And today it's an impressive one, I gotta say.
Really? So this was my pick.
This is your pick.
And your
This is
first time.
so for this video, we are discussing the 2005 David Cronenberg movie, A History of Violence, starring Viggo Mortensen, Maria Bello, Ed Harris, and William Hurt.
Yes,
Just
yeah.
an incredible cast.
Oh, unbelievable cast. Yes. That's one of the things that I was really drawn to was the incredible cast. But I saw this movie a number of years ago and I just rewatched it again. And I was pleasantly surprised that I enjoyed it every bit as much as I had the first time I ever saw it. So I'm curious for your take on it because this was your virgin tour on.
Yeah, so this isn't a fun movie. Like when I first went into it, I thought this was going to be a standard action movie, a revenge movie, but it's not that at all. There is action, there's violence, clearly. This is a family drama.
It definitely is a family drama, but I think there is revenge or an
There's
attempt at.
some, but it's such a like it's such a minor plot device. It's not what the movie focuses on. This is a meditation on the rippling effects of violence.
Certainly.
So
And it's
like there are violent episodes and violent scenes, but where the movie excels is where you see the emotional impact of that violence on those around you.
oh yeah, absolutely. And not only that, but there's well, I mean, there's a whole thing with a family dynamic because let getting into the plot, this is about a family in a small but relatively small town. You see the town behind Dominic, and
Almost an idyllic town.
yes,
Like
very much
small
so.
town, rural
Yeah.
life, peaceful.
The sheriff is still like a he it's the town's small enough that he's able to, he knows most of the people and he tries they're like family to him. He tries to take care of everybody. Everybody knows everybody else. The main character, Viggo Mortensen, he's running a small diner in the town, and everybody in the town goes there every morning. He has a son, a daughter, a beautiful wife, Maria Bello. And they're well known in the town until one night violence is visited upon them in the form of two really extremely violent criminals who are passing through, need money, and decide to rob the diner and commit mayhem in the diner. They're about to do that when they make a move on somebody that Viggo Mortensen has for an employee and cares about, and he proceeds to yeah. Those are the two,
Those are
those
the
are the two
two.
criminals, and he proceeds to rain hell on these people that are threatening him and people he that work for him, and when he cuts loose in the diner, it's extreme violence. Everybody's kind of shocked because this guy looks like your calm, easygoing guy, and
I don't
suddenly
know. Viggo Mortensen, there's no way I would look at this guy and say this guy is just like a chill wallflower.
well, I mean, he's walking around talking very up until the moment this happens. Everybody that knows him in the town sees him as this guy that's just like he talks soft, asks how
Yeah,
everyone's
he's
doing.
salt of the earth.
Yes. So when this happens and he takes these guys out and takes them out fast and hard, everybody's like, oh my God, he like suddenly turned into Dirty Harry. And he becomes the local media star in the area. and unfortunately ends up on the cover of a couple of newspapers. And that's not good because he is not who he seems to be. And that's when this movie really...
people from his past come looking for him.
Yeah, yeah. And yes, if you happen to be somebody that we're working for and with bad guys like the men in these pictures, Ed Harris and I forgot the name of the actor that's behind you.
This is Stephen McHattie, and yes. I find it hilarious that this guy is one of my favorite actors, and not because I think he's a phenomenal actor. I think he's a good actor.
Yeah.
But it's not like I would say, if you want to see phenomenal acting, watch this guy. But the roles he's in are fascinating to me.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And I find it funny that, like, we've had Christopher Walken on twice. We've done Christopher Walken movies. Yes,
yep.
Like, this is the first time we've done Ed Harris or William Hurt.
Yeah, that I can think of. Yeah.
Movie. But this is the second Stephen McHattie film we've done, and I've got one on the one I'm going to choose.
Nice.
Has him in the starring role.
Right, right.
So I find it hilarious that this guy, who is certainly not a household name, is going to be the guy, the one actor we will have the most on our YouTube channel, at least for a little while.
Right, right. Oh, yeah. No, again, I think the cast was fun. I think the movie itself, I really believe the movie is, I think the revenge is an aspect of it, because we learn that Viggo Mortensen's brother is connected. His brother works for the mob, is a member of the mob. They may even be made men, or his brother is becoming a made man. But anyway,
I thought the deal was that his brother, Viggo Mortensen's character, Joey Cusack,
yes,
killed a made man.
I thought there was actually like a provision, and it was like, you need to bring your brother in, and unless you can bring your brother in, you don't actually get the made man.
So category. Again, it's, I guess it's revenge adjacent.
Yeah, yeah,
But really, his brother is sending these men more for his own career advancement.
Yeah.
He doesn't care.
And he actually does kill, when he kills Ed Harris, because Ed Harris comes back to get him, and he had actually taken Ed Harris's eye out with a corkscrew, which I thought was hilarious. And why he didn't kill him, took his eye out, because you don't leave somebody like that alive.
I know that there are a number of unanswered questions. Again, great movie, great script, great cast, great actors. But like, there are, every now and then there are things like in shortly after that scene behind you.
Right.
Viggo's character gets shot in the chest.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I mean, and he's in the hospital for like what? Not even a full day.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. That was actually like, he also had taken a round to the foot too, didn't he? Something happened to his foot.
No, he got stabbed in the foot.
He got stabbed in the foot. Yeah. There were two things that would have kept the normal person down for a long time. And certainly the shot in the chest. And that's one of the things, because growing up in the era that I did, I remember in Westerns, you used to always see a guy like, he'd get shot in the shoulder. And they'd be like, you all right? And it'd be like, yeah, we cleaned through. I'm fine. You just had a bullet go through you. And it's like, anybody, and you do know that just doesn't happen. You don't just stick.
This movie that we're reviewing is in modern times.
Yeah.
But any Westerns with a lack of antibiotics, you could get shot in a foot and that would be lethal.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean, look at World War. Look at the Civil War, how many people had lost limbs. They were cutting legs and arms off left and right. in the Civil War. You know, it's like, it was like, oh, you got shot in the arm. Well, we got to take that off. You know, and it's like, what? It's not like, you know, it's not like nowadays they have microsurgery and all kinds of, you know, techniques and antibiotics. But my God, you know.
Did you know, and this is completely random, this has nothing to do with any movie, but I just find it fascinating because I like medical history. There was a surgery done that killed three people.
Really?
I can't remember what the surgery was. Again, I didn't expect to be talking about this, so I haven't reviewed it, but it's always in the back of my mind. This guy was doing an amputation, and he did it so fast that the patient ended up dying. He cut his assistant, killing
I
him. And
wow.
some and it was a it was there was an audience. There were like other doctors
Wow.
exploring. It was so violent. One of them had a heart attack and died.
I'll bet, yeah. I would have had a heart if something had been cut off of me by the guy who was doing the surgery so fast. I probably would have had, I would have went, what? I would have fallen over and had a heart attack. Jeez.
But anyway, I'm sorry. Back to the movie.
No, because you're absolutely right. He took some damage in this movie, and he, you know, like a Timex, he took a licking and kept on ticking. But I
So
love
we,
the, yeah, go ahead.
go on,
Well,
please.
I was just gonna say, I love the action in the movie. And I, you know, it was some of the scenes were a little bit stereotypical, but the son in the high school that was getting picked on, I liked it when he stood up and, you know, and all of a sudden it's like, oh, geez, you know, he's his father's son, you know. But yeah, there were different things going on in the movie, different, and the parents really weren't aware because the kid was getting picked on in school. I mean, before this happened, in some ways, this whole thing turned out to be a cathartic time for the kid because he actually saw that his father was a, he thought of his father as being kind of a soft-toned, weak guy, and that's kind of how everyone in the town thought of him, and they thought his son was the same way, and they were really picking on this kid. And all of a sudden, the kid, you know, turns around and blasts the kid in the face and
You see,
takes his
that
friend
is
out.
not at all how I took it.
Yeah, really.
He wasn't really picked on. He was getting threatened. He was getting bullied, but I saw no evidence that he was getting beaten up at the time. Like it wasn't a violent bullying. It was bullying. It was standard high school bullying. And the son never would have become that violent had his, I'm guessing, stepfather, like basically killed two people in his diner.
Well,
And
I don't know.
then the son, like, he blows someone away through his chest. He gives him a shotgun to the chest. That kid is going to need years of therapy. That is not cathartic.
Well, the end of this movie, let's face it, because that's, I was going to wait until the end really to, but at the end of the movie is this scene. And this is a family in trauma, absolutely in trauma. I mean, I really, when I looked at the scene the first time and the second time, I felt it was a family that was going to recover from this because there was a lot of love in this family. And I mean, his wife loved him enough, even though she's furious and she's damaged by the fact that she feels that she doesn't truly know her husband. But she was willing to sit down and not only lie to the cop to keep him out of trouble by saying, I mean, she starts crying and saying how, you know, hasn't our family been through enough? And the sheriff's like, oh, yes, you know, I'm sorry, and backs off because he's looking into, like, he can't figure out, like, why are these mob people coming to the town after you? It
And
doesn't make
rightly
sense.
so. I mean, let's
And
face it, the whole thing was so fishy.
oh, his wife figured it out. She knew what was going on, but she still covered for him, and she did the whole crying act. She put her head down behind his back and hugged him, and did the whole crying. I waited until the sheriff drove off, and him saying, "Oh, thanks, hon." And she looks at him and goes, "Get off me!" Like, because she's furious. But none of her actions, even though he was sleeping on the couch, none of her actions were someone that wanted him just out and was done with him. All of her actions were trying to keep the family together, but he had to go do what he did, and she knew what he was going to do. And when he came back in the house, this last scene, it's a very telling scene. I mean, the daughter does a very cute thing. She gets up and, you know, puts a plate out for him, but everybody welcomes him. The son, you know, passes the food over to him, and she's looking up.
It is not a happy reunion.
It's absolutely not. And you know, this family is going to have to go through a lot of healing. So it's not over with. I mean, it left you with a hollow feeling of like, oh my God, this family's hurt. But I did not feel that they couldn't recover from it. It was something that was it's a close, tight family, and they were willing to fight on their front lawn for each other. So, I mean, again, he had a very dark past, and this is part of his dark past right there. And I loved some of the scenes in William Hurt's house. It's when he comes in there and they set him up to be strangled. That was the scene that I was saying to you. I said, hey, when you watch the movie, watch for the scene with, how did you fuck that up? Because I think that was my favorite line in this movie. When that whole thing goes to hell, right? And he has it set up so well that it would be just an easy takeout. He even turns his back, like closing his eyes, like, I'm not going to...
Like a James Bond villain.
Yeah, really? Really?
I'm like, dude.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, no, but I'll tell you, I loved the action in this movie. I loved so much of what this movie was about. To me, it was very fun. As crazy and you know, yeah, I can understand that somebody might have some problems with a few things, like, yeah, getting shot and just bouncing right back.
Given that you're showing William Hurt, the other thing that stretched my, what was it? The willing suspension of disbelief.
Yes. Yeah.
The one thing other than that shot to the chest is William Hurt saying Broham.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
There's no way.
He said that more than once.
He said several. I'm like, there's no way he would use the word Broham.
You could have come to me, Broham. We could have fixed this. It's like, for sure, really, you could have fixed this. You just tried to strangle me, but we could fix this, you know. I think he knew why it couldn't be fixed. But again,
which is why, like, I get it, the brothers, but if he wasn't going to give him a chance to redeem himself, if his whole job was to eliminate him, why didn't he not just have him eliminate?
Right. Well, first of all, I think so much of it was, I don't think he really trusted or believed that I don't think he believed for a minute that those guys were going to be able to bring him in. I really don't. I mean, why he even thought that his henchmen could take the guy out, you know, his brother's a badass. And obviously he was the killer in the family. I mean, yeah, there he is at the end with probably now two bullet wounds in his shoulder. I don't know. I don't know if he got shot again when he was in the house, but he certainly wasn't looking too good. And his foot's probably infected too on top of it. So I doubt he's taking his antibiotics, you know. So he's certainly not following the doctor's orders of stay off the foot, you know, stay off the foot.
I've got a diner to run.
Yeah, how can I stab my feet? People to kill, roll biscuits to make, you know. I said, go ahead.
I was going to say, one of the most surprising things to me was the involvement of David Cronenberg.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
This absolutely did not seem like a film that he would make.
Yeah, yeah. It definitely was off subject matter, I guess you'd say, for Cronenberg, but and it wasn't a movie that I mean, Cronenberg's known for those cool little animatronic special effects, the weird,
He's known for body horror. That's his obsession,
Oh,
body horror.
absolutely. Absolutely. But yeah, anything involving like, I mean, could be alien, it could be whatever, some type of sci-fi, but there's always these like stop motion animatronics and things in his, weird shit in David Cronenberg movies. So this is definitely a departure from that. But Cronenberg is also known for violence and cool lines too in the movies, and this movie had a number of them, a number of really good lines, menacing characters. I felt his mark on the movie. I strongly felt it.
Oh, yes.
I really liked the cast a lot. I thought the cast was not only was it a talented cast, but everybody seemed right for the parts. The son was a pretty well cast role right there, and his wife, I love the fact that his wife, she was a really strong character, fought for her family. It was a movie that there's one of the scenes in the to my side there, that with the son's bully menacing him there in the locker room. But I felt there was a decent amount of harassment going on
Well, yeah, I
with the
mean,
bully.
let's face it, we all internally applauded when the son
Smacked
basically
the hell
put
out
them
of
in
him.
the hospital.
Well, and that was one of the things the father said to him. He said, "Okay, you have a fight." He goes, "Don't put him in the hospital," because apparently, whatever the final
Well, I mean, let's
result,
face it, that was excessive.
it was, oh yeah, he was, after the guy was down and not even fighting back, he continued to pound his face. So yeah, he definitely applied a lot of a lot of strong arm action there. But yeah, like I said, there was a little bit of, father son there, because my God, when he finally cut loose. But I don't know. Like I said, I definitely enjoyed the movie my second time of seeing it. And I, that's after you've seen a movie and you come back to it a few years later, to me, that's one of the big marks with a movie of, is this movie actually good? Is it something that can hold and stand the test of time? And this one, to me, really showed that it could, because it was a number of years ago. I think I had told you about going to see the movie, and I did see this one in a theater, and like I said, I really hadn't looked back at it again for a number of years. It's always been in the back of my head as, oh my God, that was a good movie. And so I was curious, is it going to hold up like it did? And I wondered what you would think of it too. So, and I am glad, because it seems like you definitely did enjoy it.
Oh,
If I
it's a great movie. Then again, when this movie first got on my radar, I thought it was going to be an action revenge flick.
Well, yeah, there are
It kind of
elements.
is, but if that's what you want, this is not the movie to see.
Yeah,
This
there's.
movie excels in the things peripheral to the violence.
It's, I mean, it's very much a movie about a family and violence visited upon the family. Now, it definitely through him and through their involvement with him, because he has a very, I don't know how much we really explain that to the people listening, but he is definitely, his dark past comes back after he's exposed in the paper, and the mobsters that do know him definitely come back to get him. And so unfortunately, it's his family that they choose to get at him through, because they're threatening the family. doing everything they can to try to draw him to come back to it was where it was
Philadelphia.
Yeah, that's right. It was Philadelphia. It was PA. Yeah, that's where his brother's estate is at. And that was, he swore he would not go back there again. And of course he has to go, he has no choice. But yeah, like I said, I thought the characters in this were really effective. They were,
and that's the
bad
thing.
Guys were menacing.
This was very character driven.
Yeah.
If you're in the mood for a revenge action flick, watch John Wick. Watch Old Boy. You know, this is not the film that's going to scratch that itch.
Yeah.
If you want to see phenomenal acting,
this
movie.
Yeah, is definitely it. Yeah, and it's, hey, the two, what I consider the two leads, Maria Bello and Viggo Mortensen, those two are, they great chemistry together. It's a fun family movie if you look at it in that light, with a lot of violence thrown in, a lot
it's
of trauma.
A fun violent family movie for the whole family.
Yeah. But it's not quite The Waltons. It's a little different than watching an episode of The Waltons, but nevertheless, probably more fun.
And let me go off on a tangent. Like,
sure.
Singing Viggo Mortensen's praises.
Yeah.
Like, I've seen him in a few movies and I didn't really notice, but I've seen him in more and more, and I'm just amazed at not just the range of his acting, but the overall range of his talent, period.
Yeah, absolutely.
So he's been a
favorite.
Great writer. He's done, he was in Carlito's Way.
Yep.
G.I. Jane, Lord of the Rings.
That always kind of throws me, yeah. Yeah.
You know, but also, his work is on the Lord of the Rings soundtrack.
Right. Oh, wow, really?
He sings. He does music. He's done a collaborative album with Buckethead.
Wow. I didn't know that at all. Wow.
Yeah. And I got to tell you, some of the links I'm going to add to this video, I've got a link to that album.
Huh. Wow.
On YouTube. So if you want to hear Mortensen and Buckethead team up musically.
Wow.
You can.
Huh. Yeah, that's totally news to me. I did not know.
Oh my God, I went down such a rabbit hole. I'm like, he did stuff with Buckethead, and I'm like, looking at all these videos of his.
Yeah, wow. No, that's an incredible piece of trivia that I did not know. So yeah, very cool. Well, it doesn't surprise me that he's that versatile. However, it was definitely unknown to me, but I probably would have been equally shocked if you told me that about Harris or something.
Well, yeah, but, I mean, anyone in that cast, I wouldn't expect that at all. Like, it's always fun to me when I learn about actors with other talents.
Yes.
Like Bradley Cooper in A Star Is Born and his musical ability.
Right.
Things like that. But like, I'm just reading talent after talent of Mortensen. He's a writer and he started his own publishing company.
Wow.
To put his works and other people's works out there.
Wow. No, I didn't. Yeah. That's crazy. But I'll tell you again, I've been a big fan for a long time. I just, you know, the whole cast, Cronenberg. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, Cronenberg really, I wouldn't say he doesn't make a bad movie, but he makes very few bad movies. Cronenberg's movies are something that always draws me, you know, right in.
I have not seen his Crimes of the Future yet.
Mm-mm.
Which Viggo Mortensen
no,
is
I
also
haven't
in.
Yeah. No, I haven't seen that one myself yet, but that's one we'll have to pick. But I'm glad you liked it. Because it definitely was a movie that I always felt, you know, was a cool movie that I thought people should watch. And so that was one of the big reasons for going with this movie, was to me, was you know, wanting to share it with not only the everyone out there watching, hopefully, but also, you know, with you, my movie buddy. So
yeah, I'll tell our viewers that you know, don't sleep on this one, but also it is advertised wrong. That when I saw a trailer for it, I thought it was very action oriented, and that is not what you want to watch this for.
Right. Well, I felt like there was, like, when I walked away from this movie, especially after seeing it the first time, I remember there was enough action in this that when I left the movie, I remember thinking of him, you know, like when you have you know, whatever you walk away with in your head about the lead character, I felt of him as being, well, this guy was a complete and utter badass. So even though it wasn't something that I would consider to be constant action, you know, oriented, there's enough in it that if you're somebody that likes that, if you're looking for some action in the movie, that you're looking for, you know, some a history of violence in the movie, there's enough there that this man had that history of violence. And when he revisits it on people that come across his path that are trying to do him or his family harm, he is very capable of doling it out very quickly, very effectively. And he does do that three times in this movie. So there is a certain element of that.
There's an element of that, but it's not enough of the movie that I would ever call this an action film.
Well, my feeling is it's doled out in very large helpings when it's needed. It's just enough to get the job done without turning it into. So no, I will agree with you. I understand exactly what you're saying, and I agree with you. It is not like, you know, action centric, every scene is like, you know, nonstop. It's not Old Boy. It's not, you know, it's not a James Bond movie. But go ahead.
Another piece of trivia that you might not know, and in fact, most of the cast of this movie might not know.
Huh.
This is based on a graphic novel.
Oh, is it? You know, that makes sense because it feels like one.
This is based on the graphic novel, A History of Violence by John Wagner.
Wow. Okay. That's a good piece of trivia to know.
And it's not just trivia. I am going to link to the graphic novel.
Yeah.
In the comments.
Yeah. I'd like to have that link myself.
No, if you read it, it's on the Internet Archive and fully readable. I started it. The writing's not bad. The illustration is kind of off-putting. It's not great.
Right. Yeah. You're saying the illustrator that did the graphic novel is not that great?
It's yeah. I mean, my apologies if he's listening, but she. Yeah. Let's face it. You know, I'm into comic books, and I know a lot of the big artists. Yeah. And this guy does a decent storyboard.
Yeah.
But the illustration itself is sort of primitive.
Okay. Yeah. Well, I mean, I'm curious. I want to see the link myself anyway, because it's just knowing. And also, I've always had the feeling in the back of my head that this could have been, would have been, should have been a graphic novel. So that it doesn't surprise me, but it is a bit of trivia that I did not know. So, but yeah, no, I. I'd love to see the link. Love to explore that, but yeah. So I bet his diner business though continued to be solid, because
and that's the thing. It's one of the things that resounds with you, in that, like, we saw that last scene We know the family is traumatized, but let's face it, you know that entire town is going to be traumatized. And that sheriff is not going to be looking at that guy in the same way ever.
Oh, again. No. No, and the way small town gossip is, I can't imagine that something that the sheriff isn't going to say to other people in the town isn't going to necessarily, the whisper is going to be, he must have been involved in something else, because why would these people be looking at him? Why did they come to our small town? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, there might be a little bit of a problem, at least in the short run of
you know, there's going to be fallout.
Yeah. Yeah.
And again, that's one of the strengths of the movie, is it shows how even if you win.
Yeah.
At this violent act, if you win, you still don't win.
Right. Right. Well, I mean, again, looking at this, the last scene of the movie behind me, this is definitely trauma. I mean, he's looking down, the wife and husband are still not even looking each other in the eye. Mm-hmm. And he's got, as they used to say in the old Lucy, you got a lot of explaining to do. Well, he's got a lot of explaining to do, because he has a very intelligent wife who happens to be, I believe she was an attorney.
Yeah.
And so he cannot lie to her. I mean, she can do a lot of digging about his past, and she's gonna. Mm-hmm. And so he is going to have to confess a lot of things. Maybe not exactly what he did in his past, but she's gonna know, and she's gonna either have to accept those things about him, or they're gonna have to go their separate ways. I think they were strong enough that I think they would have continued, and their children certainly really love their father. So I believe they were gonna be able to patch it up, but it's not without the trauma, and this is gonna always be hanging over him.
And this is one of the reasons why I say, like, it was, when you look at the trailer, it's sort of billed as an action, but the action scenes are not the strong scenes. This scene behind you, this is one of the strongest scenes in the movie.
It is. And it's a heavy ending. When this fades out at the end, and they fade to black in this scene for the credits, when this scene fades out, you're like, wow. you know, you're just kind of like, there's a heavy feeling on your chest, because mm-hmm. you know that this family is not just gonna, no one's just gonna be running around giving each other hugs and watching TV that night. There's gonna be a lot of
everyone lives happily ever after.
Yeah, and you're probably right. They're probably gonna be in therapy. So, I mean, the husband and wife are probably gonna be the
all of them.
Yeah, all of them.
I mean, let's face it, almost the entire town. I described it as an idyllic, like, small, sleepy town where everyone knows each other. And suddenly there were at least five homicides in the span of maybe a week.
Yeah, yeah. Which means the homicides went up five times, probably what they were. So yeah. No, so, it was not a town that was used to that.
Trivia time, if you will indulge me.
Sure.
With this scene behind me right now.
Yeah.
And I'm reading this. I can't remember if I got this from Wikipedia or from IMDb.
Yeah.
But I'm going to read it verbatim.
Yeah.
During an interview, Viggo Mortensen stated that during the shooting of the first bar scene with Ed Harris, he could not stop laughing.
Oh, really? And
as a result, the scene had to be reshot several times. Due to Viggo Mortensen's behavior, Ed Harris completed the scene without pants.
Really?
He only wore his underwear, yet this cannot be seen as the bar table impedes our view.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Thus, Viggo Mortensen had to act seriously while Ed Harris was not wearing pants.
Wow, that's crazy, and that's really funny. because
I laughed so hard when I read that.
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense, because now it's going to make me want to go back and rewatch the scene. So yeah, for anyone that's watching this movie, and if you have or haven't seen the movie, now you have to go back and watch that scene, just because he was not wearing pants, the scene behind Dominic there. But as opposed to this guy here who was wearing pants in this scene when the first violent act comes out. But yeah, that's the scene behind Dominic, is when these two guys come into the ones behind Dom, Ed Harris and his henchmen, come into the diner and start making all kinds of, he keeps calling him Joey, and he goes, "Thanks for the coffee, Joey," and he's trying to correct him and saying, "I'm not Joey, and you got me mixed up with somebody else. Oh, I think I know who you are, Joey." So yeah, I could see how it would be extremely funny if, yeah, he wasn't wearing pants and he's sitting there saying, "Really good coffee, Joey."
There is no way I could have
Yeah.
kept a straight face.
No. Oh no. I have trouble keeping a straight face when we're doing these. And
Well, we don't keep straight faces.
yeah, no, not for very long. But a lot of times, if something, and just so anybody that's watching knows, if you know me at all, if something strikes me funny, you could have me laughing for the rest of the entire movie talk, because once I go off, it can be truly, truly bad. But yeah, I wouldn't have been able to, I wouldn't have been able to get to that scene. So I would have said,
And if I could give you one more trivia story.
sure.
So, as you mentioned to me,
Yeah.
we don't have any scenes. For those of you at home, we don't have any scene, or at least I don't have any scenes of this.
Yeah.
There is a semi-violent lovemaking scene on a set of
Oh,
stairs.
yeah. Yep. Yeah. Yes, there is. And actually, I mean, for as violent as it is, it's actually fairly erotic. There it is right
There
there.
it is. There it
Yes.
is.
And yeah, it's both violent and also very passionate. It flirts with the edges of, I wouldn't say consent, because I mean, she's fully in, believe me, when they start, the biggest thing is he's trying to hold on to her. She's pulling away and saying, "Get off me." And she's starting to go up the stairs, and they're kind of like pulling at each other, and he kind of begins kissing her. She immediately responds to his kisses, but it's very violent. Or she's very angry with him.
When you hear the phrase making violent love, this is
Yes.
what they mean, or
Yes,
violent love
absolutely.
making.
Yeah, and this is another scene there where they're against the wall, and ultimately she kind of collapses on the stairs, and they are just making violent, passionate love. Thank God the kids are out of the house at the time. But at
So
any rate,
knowing this was in the script,
yes.
Cronenberg was concerned about their safety for the scene, and he consulted their stunt director,
Oh, really? Yeah.
who mentioned
Wow.
that this is the first time in movie history a stunt director has ever been called to advise on a lovemaking scene, on a sex scene.
Yeah. Well, I seem to remember watching an interview with Maria Bello, where she was talking about bruises all over her butt and back, because they did several takes on the stairs. And to the point where he was offering like to be the person like on the bottom, but she said it won't work. You've got to be, because you have to be the aggressor in this, because she's mad at him, and she is actually kind of moving up the stairs, but then ultimately they're still just can't resist each other. And even after it's all over, it's funny because he kind of collapses on the stairs. And he kind of like reaches out his hand to her ankle, and she just like kicks his hand away, like, "Get off me!" Like, you're sleeping on the couch too. But
Yeah, I heard they had to use quite a bit of makeup to hide the bruises for
Oh, I'll bet.
subsequent scenes.
Yeah, I'll bet, because it was there are moments where he's down on the stairs, and there's moments where she is, and they're slamming each other back and forth against the wall. It was very much like an angry lovemaking or something. It was, but obviously very passionate too. But their chemistry is great together, though. I mean, she just seemed like somebody that it was. She was very into him, and he was very into her, and that to me is part of the biggest reason I felt like, they loved each other. There was passion. There was a lot of emotion between the two of them. They were playful with each other before this whole thing had happened. There was the whole, she dressed up doing the cheerleader thing and just trying to, like, be playful with them. These two were very into each other. She did the really, really intelligent, very, very conniving little play with the cop, where she's messing with him to make him think that she's crying, so that he leaves them alone about, looking more
I don't know.
into.
I thought that was an acted first, but I don't think that was. I think she was really bright.
Well, I mean, I think she made herself cry, but
Right.
as soon as the she kind of looked up to see if he had driven out of the driveway, and he's looking up too, and then as soon as he did, he was like, oh, thanks, honey, and she's like, you get away from me, and because she was mad. But so, like I said, I think she was able to turn it on and turn it off when she needed to. But they were a suited couple. They weren't Both of them were relatively, or very much so, good characters. But he had definitely gone through a catharsis of, he was no longer the person that he was. He had changed his modus operandi of being a killer in his earlier life, to suddenly he's a very, low brew family man that's just into his wife and kids. But he certainly has it revisited upon him, though. And the bad thing is, they're probably going to have to move again, because those, if there's anyone else that's left alive that can, although the ability and the wanting to go after him at this point would be a lot much less, because it's really on the brother, and the brother's dead now. So, but
I don't think, I mean, there's a possibility, a history of violence too.
well, and that hasn't happened. So I have a feeling it was probably all over with that. But at the same time, it's definitely, I mean, just telling your family afterwards, telling your wife, like, yeah, I did these, like, really awful things. So that in itself is going to be quite a lot of explaining to do. So
And that's the thing, like, phenomenal movie, but I gotta stress that if anyone goes into it, the violence isn't the star. It's the emotional fallout from the violence.
it's less about it, you wouldn't have to give any warnings of, like, oh my God, if you're somebody that can't take, like, graphic violence, don't watch this. That's not the warning to give you in this one. You really,
Although there is some graphic violence.
yeah, there is, but there's a surprising amount of it that happens off camera, because even the sons fight in school. Once you see, like, initial punches, you basically are seeing the person on top that's driving the punches down. You're when it comes to a gun, the gun's raised, but the person being shot is kind of, like, off camera most of the time. So it's I think,
Like
and yeah,
this
this is
scene.
a this thing, I have to ask you this too, now that you brought up that scene, because I don't have that one in my screenshots. But when I first saw this movie, and it did it to me the second time too, I actually was thinking, when they started showing this scene, I was thinking, oh, this is a scene of Viggo Mortensen, how he was supposed to be when he was young. I was thinking like this was another character like portraying him when he was young. And I thought, because there's a this particular guy that's behind you, there's a scene where the main bad guy, which we can bring up, but the main bad guy tells him to go in the office after the main bad guy has already been in there, and he tells him, just get some ice for the road, it's going to be hot. And he goes inside, and I was thinking to myself that that guy was probably the better of the two. And and if anything, he was as bad or worse, because when he goes inside, a little girl comes out from behind the back room and she's crying and she's got a doll up. And the younger guy, the one that's in the car, does a shh, sure, and then takes a pistol out and you don't see it, but he shoots her. And this guy behind me, the one in the black jacket, that's the main bad guy. And so they're equally as evil. And so I was thinking to myself, my God, did he kill a little kid when he was younger? And so I was thinking that that was actually maybe him, you know, when, again, as a younger, but
See,
that's
I got
not
to
what.
admit, I would have loved to have heard a little more about what he was like what
Yeah.
we like got vague references to his reputation,
As being a killer, yeah.
but like it's not like we get any of the stories in John Wick. He killed him with a pencil.
Yeah, oh yeah.
You know,
What?
so we don't really know, like, how bad was he? Was he an
Right.
absolute monster? Did he just kill a made man and that's it?
Well,
And everyone's after him?
again, this character behind me right now, you know, the Ed Harris character, he at one point when he's talking to the wife, and he goes, like, you don't know Joey, how Joey was, but Joey was a very good killer. And I mean, he's going on and on about Joey and Joey being this killer.
He is,
And
but he is not the most reliable witness.
no, that's true. That's true. Because when you hear more about what happened between the two of them, he goes after him because Ed Harris's character is a truly evil mob guy. And he goes after him and takes his eye out. Probably doesn't kill him, because the guy is a made guy. And that is actually probably the reason why the mob has never like gone for more out to get him. But they do challenge his brother, you need to rein your brother in. And that was part of the deal, I believe, for the brother to become a made man, was you got to take your brother, either take him out or bring him back in. And of course, no, nobody could do it. There's a scene where they try and it doesn't end well for anybody. Yeah, it, like I said, I had a lot of fun with the movie years ago, and I had a lot of fun watching it again. To me, as far as action goes, I agree it's not action centric. However, there's a healthy dose of it, and it's just enough for me to make it a fun, watchable movie, with some, you know, with some great acting and great characters. That's what I would recommend to everybody if you haven't seen it. I would say indeed check this movie out.
Yeah, I give it 2 thumbs up, no
Yeah,
question. Yeah,
definitely.
unequivocally. I would not call this fun. Those 2 thumbs up are from almost the heart-rending performances that this cast
Well,
gives.
I would say two thumbs up, then an additional thumb up for fun.
I draw the line at 2 thumbs.
Yeah. If there was a way for me to make a third thumb, that's
There is, but
a
it's not allowed on
thumb.
YouTube.
I would say that, yeah, there should be a fun thumb too. So now,
Let's
now
drop
I'm gonna
that one.
now I'm gonna yeah, really. Now I'm gonna have to get a plastic third thumb for if there's a lot of fun in a movie. So that's our new shtick, by the way, is the plastic third thumb. So, but yeah, again, I highly recommend the movie. I think people will truly enjoy it. It's to me, there's nothing not to like. I just feel like because you're not gonna there's if you're somebody that's a little too worried about violence, you're definitely not gonna see so much. If this is too violent for you, then you need to probably just watch Disney movies. I don't know what else to tell you because this is it's not too violent, but at the same time, it's not a you know a rom-com either. So let's not go there.
But
But
yeah, I mean, that's all there is to say. Solid
yeah.
movie.
Yep, I think we've kind of exhausted it. And I would just say to people, if you please would leave that like and subscribe. We hate saying that, but we need to because we need the support. We badly need the support. We need the likes. We need the subscriptions if you can possibly do that for us too. Keep coming back. We're here to stay, hopefully. We're
We'll be back next week.
we enjoy doing this. Next week's gonna be Dom's pick. He's gonna pull something fun out, I'm sure. And if not fun, it'll be something else. It'll be scary or it'll be
We're
whatever.
just plain weird.
Yeah, just weirdness. So but please come back again and check us out. But yeah. Dom, I certainly had fun and I'm
Always fun.
anxious to find out what you've got for us next week. So with that, I will tell you and whoever's still watching out there, please come back next week and see you next week. Thanks a
We'll
lot.
see y'all.
Bye.